This video is sponsored by Squarespace, the best way to create your website. In digital cinematography, sensor size isn't just a technical detail, it's a storytelling tool. For decades, Super 35 dominated cinema, shaping the look of everything from intimate documentaries to Hollywood blockbusters. But in recent years, full frame or large format digital sensors have reshaped the industry. From early prosumer cameras like the Canon 5D Mark II, to modern cinema workhorses like the Sony Venice and Arri Alexa Mini LF, they've opened up new aesthetic possibilities. So in this video, let's break down the differences between Super 35 and full frame sensors. From field of view and depth of field, to lens compatibility and noise performance, we'll explore how each format influences your image, your workflow, and ultimately your story. The reason Super 35 and full frame cameras look different comes down to sensor size. Before digital, most films were shot on Super 35. This used 35mm film running vertically through the camera, recording an image area roughly 18mm tall by 24mm wide. Large format systems like VistaVision, 70mm or IMAX did exist, but they were niche tools used for only a handful of productions. So when digital cinema cameras arrived, most manufacturers modeled their sensors on Super 35 dimensions. Later down the line, however, manufacturers started to produce digital cameras primarily designed for still photography, which could also record video. Unlike 35mm cinema cameras, which recorded the image onto vertical strips of film with perforations on either side, still photography 35mm cameras, also called 135, were designed so that the film was flipped horizontally, with sprockets on the top and bottom to capture frames with a greater surface area of approximately 24mm tall by 36mm wide. So, when these digital photography cameras, which could also record video, such as the Canon 5D Mark II, started getting produced, they had a 24mm by 36mm size sensor. To differentiate this larger sensor video format from Super 35 sensors, it was labeled as full frame. Today, cinema cameras like the Sony Venice, Arri Alexa Mini LF and Blackmagic Pixus continue this full frame tradition, sitting alongside the more traditional Super 35 options. The most obvious difference between the two formats is field of view. If you put the same lens on both sensors, the full frame camera captures more of the lens's image circle, resulting in a wider frame. Super 35, being smaller, crops in, producing a narrower frame. This crop factor is about 1.5 times, so a 35mm lens on Super 35 gives you a field of view closer to a 50mm lens on full frame. To match framing, you'd need to use a wider lens on Super 35. For example, a 35mm lens on a full-frame camera gives approximately the same field of view as a 24mm on Super 35. So, as a very rough rule, Super 35 needs a prime lens about one focal length wider to match a full-frame shot. But here's the key, changing focal length doesn't just change framing, it also changes the look of the image. But before we get into that, a quick thank you to my sponsor, Squarespace. It's a given these days that every business needs a website, whether you sell products or your own freelance film services. I use Squarespace to set up separate sites, both for displaying my creative portfolio to advertise my work as a DP, as well as for posting blog-style videos and articles related to this channel. Squarespace's design intelligence allows anyone to build a website and unified online presence, which is customized to their needs. They are also business friendly, with Squarespace payments making it easy to onboard and start receiving payments from customers for your products. Head to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/indepthcine to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Because framing on full frame often requires longer focal lengths, the result is a shallower depth of field. This means backgrounds fall more out of focus, even in medium or wide shots, creating a stronger sense of separation between subject and background. On Super 35, you'll typically use wider lenses for the same framing. Wider lenses have deeper depth of field, so more of the scene remains in focus. This contributes to the classic filmic aesthetic of 20th century cinema. Full frame often feels more immersive and dimensional, with compressed backgrounds and a pronounced bokeh. Super 35 feels more traditional, with images that keeps characters and environments more evenly balanced in focus. Super 35 also has a practical advantage: lens availability. Because the format has been standard for so long, most cinema lenses, especially vintage glass, were designed to cover Super 35, not full frame. Each lens comes with an image circle, which is the diameter of the circular cone of light projected by the lens. Most cinema lenses from the past were manufactured with an image circle which was only wide enough to cover the size of Super 35 film or sensors. Many of these older Super 35 lenses will vignette heavily on full frame. Full frame sensors therefore require lenses with a larger image circle. That means your options are more limited to either modern cinema lenses built for large format, or rehouse still lenses originally designed for 1.35 or medium format photography. These can be more expensive and harder to source. The upside for choosing a Super 35 camera is that full frame lenses will always cover its sensor. However, Super 35 lenses won't necessarily cover full frame cameras. There's also a special format that uses a special type of lens called anamorphic. If you want to shoot with anamorphic lenses, which produces this widescreen format, then you'll most likely have to use a Super 35 camera, as most 2x anamorphic lenses are designed to cover this smaller sensor. There are a few niche lenses for large format with anamorphic squeeze, which year by year are being manufactured more frequently. However, even more so than with spherical glass, with anamorphic the options for large format are still quite limited. In short, if you're drawn to the vast world of vintage cinema glass or anamorphic lenses, then Super 35 offers more choices. Sensor size also impacts low light performance and noise. If two sensors have the same resolution, the larger full frame sensor will usually have bigger pixels. Bigger pixels gather more light, producing a cleaner signal to noise ratio. This translates into full frame sensors generally having better high ISO performance in low light conditions, cleaner shadows, and often more usable dynamic range, since you can recover more detail from the shadows without noise overwhelming the image. Of course, it depends on the model of the camera, but as a general rule, full frame cameras will produce a cleaner image in low light conditions than Super 35 cameras. You'll usually be able to push the ISO or sensitivity on full frame cameras higher before noise becomes noticeable, although for high-end cinema cameras, this is negligible. Ultimately, neither format is better, they're just different tools. If you're shooting in locations with tight spaces and need a wider field of view, then a full frame camera may be better. Or if you're after a greater variety of vintage lenses, then Super 35 may be better. Full frame offers wide, immersive frames, shallow depth of field, and strong low light performance. Super 35 delivers a more controlled classic film look with a wider variety of lens availability and deep ties to cinematic history. The choice comes down to story, location, and budget. Do you need the expansive depth and dimensionality of full frame, or the vintage glass and timeless feel of Super 35? Thanks as always for supporting the channel, especially those of you on Patreon. Until next time, thanks for watching and goodbye.